I grew up in a monolingual family.
Right.
My mother spoke Burmese.
Hmm.
My father spoke Konkani and Portuguese.
Hmm.
The link language between the two of them was English. So we got English in, as our patrimony and as our matrubhasha, if you want to use that slightly, you know, colonial word. That's what we spoke.
Right.
I once remember going in the third, around the third standard. This must have been around the early 70s. Right. The government required all children in state-aided schools to state their mother tongue. And a form was, you know, and the teachers had to fill out the form and send it up to the government. So we'd know how many students speak what.
Right.
So I went to them and I said, they want to know my mother tongue. And my mother said, English.
English.
That's my tongue. That's my language. So I went home, went back to class and I said, English. And the teacher said, are you Anglo-Indian? So I said, no, I don't have British blood as far as I know. He said, only Anglo-Indians can claim English as a mother tongue. Where do you come from? I said, Goa. She said, then your mother tongue is Konkani. She wrote down Konkani and that was it.
Mm.
So I did not even get a choice of that language, a language that I understand but do not speak.
Right.
I grew up at a time when if you were monolingual in English, everyone told you that your life was blighted, that you would never get a job if you could only speak English,
okay,
however well you spoke it. We were told repeatedly through school and college that knowing Hindi, Marathi, Gujarati, that was the passport to success.
Yeah.
English was only a road to failure. This has completely inverted itself.
Yeah.
But I remember being told this and being terrified because I did not speak those languages well. I did not read them well. I think it was the way we were taught language in schools.
Right.
You know, poetry was tortured into us.
Mm.
We were required to recite poems from memory.
Mm.
We were required to recite verse 3 and verse 7, literally like dodging.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
You're required to tease out the meaning,
mm.
you know, to explain what it said.
Mm.
There was never the beauty and the rhythm and of the language was never revealed to us.
Mm.
And so the result was you developed an aversion to these languages.
Mm.
But
right.
I remember reading, thinking to myself one day, parochial forces have made me reluctant to study Marathi in a city of many tongues. And it's a city of so many tongues that it has no language. Words blew into Bombay, you know, so that lots and lots of the Marathi that we speak today comes out of Urdu and Arabic. Like Samil Vaha, you say, Shamil.
Oh, right.
Khalas, which is actually means broken,
okay,
in Arabic. These are words that, so in this multi-tongued city,
right,
where hundreds of languages are being spoken, not one language is associated with the city,
hmm,
except Bambaiya,
hmm,
which is always said as a pejorative and a put down.
Absolutely.
But here I was sitting next to these lakes.
Hmm.
I was sitting next to a lake of Marathi literature.
Mm.
I could read Hindi literature.
Mm.
I could read Gujarati.
Mm.
And I wasn't. And I thought, why aren't you? And I started. And then one day, suddenly, I was reading an article in the Indian Express in which my friend Shanta Gokhale had listed a series of books which he thought was important, which were the important books that had come out recently in Marathi. There was nice column that the Indian Express did regularly, asked respected and literateurs in different languages to nominate these new voices.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, yeah, I've got a ready-made reading list. So I went out and bought the books that she'd suggested. One of them was Cobalt Blue.
Mm-hmm.
And as I read it, an odd thing started to happen. And this is truth, this is not imagined.
Okay.
I began to try to translate the first line.
Mm-hmm.
I began to hear it in English as if I just kept on playing with it and not being satisfied, and halfway through the book I thought, I am reading this book as if I am going to translate it.
Hmm.
I don't know why. So I called up Shanta and I said, do you think I could translate Cobalt Blue? And she said, you, with an exclamation mark at the end. Now she could have said you with a question mark at the end. You with a question mark would have stopped me dead in my tracks.
Hmm.
And this I think is something as a teacher. I think I got a huge lesson in how if you have a someone who is like whom you, a mentor or a guru or a person you respect, if they have faith in you, you are given permission to have faith in yourself. And so that was just like my, as though someone had stamped my visa to translator Nagri, you know, like, go try, you know. And I thought, I remember starting and struggling with that first line. Because the first line of Cobalt Blue is just incredibly difficult. It says something like that you should not be here on a day when something we have both wanted to happen is finally happening is not new to me.
Right.
Yeah. In Marathi, this works beautifully and lyrically. And it sets the tone for the book. Loss, biraha is not new. This has happened before. We've both wanted this, but you're not here to enjoy the happy. I remember working with that line for days, then abandoning it, saying, okay, theek hai, I'll leave you alone now. I'm going to go on writing. I'll come back to you again. I would come back and go from that first line, because nothing was as challenging, I think, except that little word re. You know, kai re, you say in Marathi. There's a little rhythm to that re, which we have in Konkani as re. Kit re, we'd say. But re in Konkani is a little more affectionate than re. Re has a tonality that suggests, you're a bit of an idiot, but I love you anyway.
Yeah, like,
you
know, an endearment sort of a thing.
You can't bring these little tonal patterns into English. So what you've got to do is then work with the emotional tone of the line. The whole line has to reflect that re.
Okay.
That re is a missing person now, but it must inflect the line. So, and if you have had a love affair with language, then translation is like falling in love with the language you're writing in again,
right,
and having a mad passionate affair with another language,
right,
at the same time.
So when you translate works like, you know, Daya Pawar's Baluta, one can understand that there is a certain level of activism, political consciousness, you know, driving translation of a work like that. But I want to pick this beautiful phrase from Susan Sontag's book, which she says regarding the pain of others. And while we understand, and this is a rather philosophical idea that one can never truly understand the pain of the other, and you cannot. But then when you do step into that zone, and when you are talking about it, what is your speaking position? What is your writing position then?
Okay. I think translation for me is an act of humility. There are people who, and not false humility. It actually is about a moment when you must set aside the ego. There is a whole strand of translation theory that believes that every translation is a transcreation. You're making a new object. And I accept that, because, you know, when you think about losing the re in a sentence, what happens to that sentence? You do create a fresh artifact in a certain sense.
Sure.
But as soon as you open the door and say that is possible, then you can rewrite the end. Then you can rephrase a sentence. Then you can rephrase a thought. Then where is the limit? I believe that when anyone picks up Baluta by Daya Pawar, they are buying it for Daya Pawar. They're not buying it for Jerry Pinto. If I believed that, I'd do probably a different job. So my name and who I am must be pulled back in a certain way. And in a certain way, I have to release some sense of how I could be as a writer if I were not this writer. Because I'm not Daya Pawar.
Sure.
I will never be Daya Pawar. I will never have his experiences.
Right.
I will never know what it meant to be the kind of person who wrote a poem in which a tree shivers in agony. When I translated that poem, I remember thinking, would I ever write a line like this? And I thought, no, I would never. But I have never lived a life like that. So why would that line occur to me?
Right.
So at all the times we make literary judgments about other people's work, in translation especially, you've got to be very careful about trying not to do that, about holding yourself back. And so therefore for me, the position that I have is of, I don't know, a very, I think, a good choreographer. I'm not the dancer. The dance is the dance of words that is being presented in that original text and which I've changed. I'm in the background saying this, this, this is what is on offer. You read and be the co-creator of that with Daya Pawar. I just helped. So, okay, maybe I'm the boatman who brings the pilgrims across the water. The pilgrims are on the pilgrimage, not the boatman.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
The pilgrims go out and achieve darshana. They are seen and they see the deity and the deity sees them.
Right. Right.
And that's what I think also reading a translation is. You go and you see and you are seen by that text. That text will change you.
Right.
You will change the text in your reading of it. So my position is a position of, I'm not a restrained person by nature.
Absolutely.
But
sure.
In this act, I exercise extreme control of who I think I am.
Mm-hmm.
It will leak. Mm-hmm. You will always leak into your text.
Mm-hmm.
But you cannot, if you spot a deliberate leaking, you must pull it back. You cannot be self-indulgent.